A future of healthcare without walls was the terminology that we evolved to describe a system that is a much more technologically enabled, distributed form of healthcare. We think that there are a lot of drivers behind this movement. To state the obvious, many of you are well aware of them. And actually, I'm sorry, I'm having trouble seeing my own slides here. We don't have a confidence monitor, so maybe I'll come out of here in front so I can do it a little bit better. What we think we're seeing is this whole series of drivers that include dramatic advances, obviously, in science and technology, the digital delivery platform. We see care already, of course, as we know, moving outside of institutions to homes, to offices, and of course to outpatient settings as well. The drive toward consumerism and retailization of care is obviously augmenting this, and of course, population health approaches, trying to figure out how we can make a better degree of changes in the underlying health of the population before they get sick, before they come into institutional settings. So that's going on. We know we're still expanding coverage, at least for now, in this country. The population is growing, so we've got more people we've got to get care to. As I say, given the poor health of the population, we understand we've got to attack these upstream drivers of health that are leading people to become sick and ideally keep them from becoming sick. Then, of course, as we know, we've got the high cost of the existing system and the fact that we really know that the spending growth, even though it's been moderate for the last several years, is not sustainable for our nation. We have got to figure out a way to take cost out of the system and use whatever dollars we're going to put into the system as effectively as possible. So we know all of that's going on, but we also know that many obstacles to the drift of healthcare outside of institutional settings are formidable. We have ongoing reimbursement and payment challenges. Just today, bunches of people are lobbying up on Capitol Hill to get Medicare to do more in the realm of telehealth, as Patrick Conway will probably talk about later today, Patrick from CMS. We have a lot of regulatory issues, of course, a lot of them having to do with our essentially state-based regulation of healthcare, and whether it is the kinds of issues that Hank Chaudhry at the Federation of is working on around the compact to enable more telehealth across state lines, whether it is scope of practice issues at the state level. We know all of those are barriers against this movement as well. We know there are many human factors to be dealt with, just the way humans interrelate with technology. And we're delighted that Pascal Carrion from University of Wisconsin, who's a leading expert in this field, will be here today to address that. And then, of course, the workforce composition is probably going to have to be different from what it is now if we're going to be able to avail ourselves of a lot more care delivery outside of institutional settings. Then, may I bring up the I word, inertia. We know inertia affects most aspects of human existence, and healthcare is obviously no exception to that. And the inertial forces militating against the disruptive forces obviously continues to be an ongoing issue. So the goals of our project, frankly, are to put all of that in a big pot and say, what do we do now? How do we create a vision of healthcare without walls 2025? How do we enumerate the most important strategies to getting there? How do we make sure we're identifying the right obstacles and addressing the right ways to overcome them? We're going to do that by creating a series of work streams devoted to a number of these areas, as you know. And the goal is to have these work streams over the course of a year delve pretty deeply into these topics and isolate the important barriers that need to be overcome and identify important policy and other changes that will help to do that. At the end of this project, we'll be publishing a lot of thought leadership on this in separate white papers. We don't just want these to disappear into cyberspace unread, of course. We want those to be used for advocacy by many of you and certainly by our organization as well to advocate for policy and other changes that will make a difference. We want to say a special thank you to those who have supported our project to this point. The Gordon and Betty Moore Foundation, Julie Lawrence is here from that foundation. Sanofi, Agnina McDonald is here from Sanofi. California Healthcare Foundation, unfortunately, was not able to get a representative here today. And the Jewish Healthcare Foundation. And Karen Feinstein is here and will be leading our second panel discussion today. Thank you very much. We could not do this without you. And we will look forward to talking with others of you who would like to support this project going forward. So to kick us off, we're going to get a great scenario in a moment from Keith Montgomery, who directs this marvelous Center for Total Health at Kaiser Permanente. We worked up a little one of our own that we wanted to share with you just because we found that there were many people we talked to, Healthcare Without Walls, that instantly the light bulb went off. And for other people, they said, what the heck are you talking about? So this is for sort of for what the heck are you talking about group. We said, okay, so imagine a story. Imagine that there's a pretty healthy guy in his mid-40s living on Kodiak Island, Alaska, named Dave. Really healthy guy, natural scientist, you can see, loves to get out and fish, Kodiak Island. So one day he develops a cough, and it's a nagging cough that won't go away. And there's not a whole lot of healthcare activity going on Kodiak Island, but so he manages to get himself to the local critical access hospital there, 25-bed hospital on Kodiak Island, and he sees a doctor, and he undergoes a number of tests, and they say, Dave, we're really sorry, but we think you have lung cancer. And so Dave, a natural scientist, internet-savvy guy, goes home, reads the internet. He's a lifelong non-smoker. He deduces he pretty clearly he has non-small cell lung cancer, which does affect many people, obviously, who are not smoking. And he determines that one of the leading experts in this field is all the way in New York City at Memorial Sloan Kettering. And so, and he reads about what should happen in this day and age. He understands that in this day and age, you probably should have your tumor sequenced. So he decides that he should undergo a biopsy and have the sequencing results, as well as the rest of his DNA sequenced, his normal DNA sequenced. And he establishes a relationship with the people at Memorial Sloan Kettering. They have a visit. They have a number of communications via telehealth. His images are all sent to Memorial Sloan Kettering. His genetic tests and other information are sent to Memorial Sloan Kettering. And they use the artificial intelligence capability that they have through their relationship with IBM Watson, which searches 200 million pages of the medical literature pretty quickly and deduces that, yes, in fact, they confirm the diagnosis. He has a particular type of non-small cell lung cancer. There's a targeted therapy that has been shown to be effective against this form. No guarantees, of course, but they think that that's the deal. So what are Dave's options? He can get on a plane and travel the more than 3,000 miles from Kodiak Island to Memorial Sloan Kettering, try to get an appointment there, stay overnight at the hotel, undergo treatment, have a consultation, stay there for 6 weeks at God knows how much of a cost, et cetera. And then what? Then what does he do? Go back to Kodiak Island, stay in New York City? Or he could do this. He could have everything I just said happen, the tumor tissue sequenced, have a telehealth conversation with Dr. Fred at MSK, have the targeted therapeutic agent identified, e-prescribed to a Seattle specialty pharmacy, which would then be delivered by drone to the critical access hospital on Kodiak Island and to his care team at Kodiak, where, by the way, there is no oncologist, but through telehealth consultations, all of this could be achieved. Now, that could happen today, except for one thing. Can anybody tell me what's the one thing in that scenario that could not happen today? Louder?
Payment.
Yep. Payment. But also, I'm thinking about the one technology thing that could not happen today. The drone. There isn't now drone service between Seattle and Kodiak Island, right? But could there be? Of course there could be. Everything else in that scenario could happen today, except for all the reasons that we know it couldn't happen today, right? Payment, inertia, nobody's done it yet. Of course, somebody would argue that it's not going to be effective care to have this kind of consultation via telehealth. And as one person pointed out to me, of course, we don't really know that targeted therapies really work that well yet. Of course, that's true. But just from the technology aspect alone, everything in this scenario could happen today, everything. Is that better than what we have today? It certainly would be very different, and it would be very disruptive, as we know, but it could happen. So that's what we want to talk about. Could we get to this vision? What are the obstacles in the way, and how do we remove them? And now I'd love to turn the clicker, at least, over to Keith Montgomery, who's the executive director here at the Kaiser Permanente Center for Total Health. And those of you who know about the innovation that has gone on in Kaiser, which now is covering one out of every 30 Americans, it's amazing. And obviously, as a system that is both a provider and a payer, one of the original payviders of the world, I guess, has the capability to envision this future. And Bernard Tyson, the CEO, has said if he were starting all over again today at Kaiser, he would start with the technology platform first and then build the rest of the system around it. And that's inspired a lot of innovative thinking at Kaiser through the Garfield Center, as well as here at the Center for Total Health. So Keith is going to lay out what we describe as a provocation. The idea is to provoke thought, of course, maybe fear among some of you, or maybe excitement among others of you. So we'll have that provocation scenario, then we'll come back up here with our first panel discussion to carry forward our talk about the vision that we think lies ahead of us for a healthcare without walls. So Keith, over to you.